The living room's dark, save for light being cast from the big TV screen and the imminent sunrise that's teasing the one starry sky with whispers of morning.
Hey, George.
Hey, Lyons. How goes it?
Dude, it's going good. And I've been thinking all day about how to be the one between the two of us that worked the phrase checkmate into into the episode. And I spent an unreasonable amount of time. I'm talking like 30 real Earth minutes this afternoon, just staring off into space while my daughter was playing with blocks, thinking like, how you can't open a conversation with check. How am I going to start a conversation with checkmate? I don't think there's a good way to do this. And needless to say, the only thing I came up with is what I'm doing right now.
Well, I mean, you could have just asked me how, you know, an Australian asks, when an Australian says when his meal is finished at a restaurant. Checkmate.
Why on earth did you have that in your quiver of... Explain yourself, sir.
I don't know, man. I'm just that witty.
Anyway.
No, I found it online like a year ago.
That's I appreciate your honesty.
But yes, we played Battle Chess.
Yes, we played Battle Chess for the Nintendo, and a lot of, I'm going to say probably half, I don't know how accurate the estimation is, but probably about half of the NES games we've played also had an arcade counterpart, right? They started as arcade cabinets, and then they became Nintendo Entertainment System cartridges. This game is one of the few, possibly the only, that started its life as an honest-to-God PC game, which is going to be relevant in a minute. So 1990 was when it hit the Nintendo, and man, is that not a disputable fact. Like, it feels like 1990.
It is 87 degrees outside, and this game was made in 1990.
Yes, precisely. Yeah. So what was your nostalgia experience for this? Because I know you're not a tweeter person, but I jabbed at you a little because I was like, when I tweeted out that we were going to play this game, I was like, this game has been highly requested by George.
Yes. Yeah. No, actually, this one, my own personal nostalgia experience was, I don't remember... I definitely owned it, but I believe if I remember correctly, no, actually, I take that back. I borrowed it, right? Because the thing was that I loved this game, and my family was like huge into chess, especially on my dad's side, and so I had it. I had my NES at my mom's. I had borrowed this, right? And I just played it, just the ever loving crap out of it, and. To the extent that when I would then play chess, like actual, like, you know, in IRL chess, and like when a piece would take another piece, I would pick them both up and like slam them against each other and make them fight because I thought that was just the coolest thing ever. And yeah, so that was basically my whole shtick to the point where now I can't remember like a time when, you know, I would play chess and not think of Battle Chess while I was playing chess. So see, that
you're just like the other person is like deep in thought, and in your mind it's just the sound of like physical combat, like melee, swords clashing, armor being rent asunder.
Yes. Yeah. And it actually, I can imagine, like, it just shows us both, you know, playing, and the other person like moves, and then you just hear like in the background like all of that, you know, noise start to happen, and it says George, yeah, it's your move. Right, sorry. What about you?
Yeah, so my neighbor, Kevin, who I've played a bunch of games with, he's come up a few other times, he had this game, and he had it on PC. So I remembered what this game looked like and sounded like pretty accurately, but not the NES cartridge. So when I first was like, you know, blowing the dust off this box and I was like, ah, Battle Chess, we're going to play Battle Chess. And I, you know, booted it up. I was like, oh, this doesn't look like I remember. Wait, let me just pop over here to Google and right. It was just
there it is.
Yeah, because it was like, and the reason I felt really ridiculous when I had that realization is I know I played this on his PC because I have clear memories, one, of him not having a Nintendo, and two, the room in his house where the computer was, because it was like in the guest room / office, you know, because this was way back when like a family computer was a thing that existed. So like, as soon as I looked at the screenshots of the graphics side by side, I was like, right, okay. The good news is, unlike a lot of arcade ports that we've played, that is basically the only difference. The PC version had much more powerful visuals, and you know the audio was like a slightly higher fidelity, but the game itself is virtually identical. There aren't additional modes. There wasn't really like a ton of other nonsense. So my experience was higher fidelity than yours, but that's about the difference. So I'm calling it a mulligan.
But yeah, so speaking of top of the hour visuals,
yeah. So, I mean, they're super early Nintendo graphics. Like, this is not Super Mario Brothers 3, right? Like, and there's a ton of information. I mean, in their defense, there is a tremendous amount of information that has to be shoved onto the screen because there's quick. How many pieces are there on each person's side of the chessboard?
Would it be 16?
Okay. You could have said virtually any number and I would have been like
7,000.
Yes, there's 7,000 pieces, right? Which means 14,000 total sprites have to be rendered.
Yeah, because let's see, what would it be? Rook, bishop, knight, queen, right? And then iterated, so that's 4 times 2, 8 times 2, 16.
Yeah, nicely done.
Yay.
I like that instead of literally just counting a number you knew confidently to be less than 20, you were like, no, I can compute this.
Just so, doing it by halves. But
yeah. So there is actually a lot of information on the screen, and granted, most of it is not moving. It does all have to be rendered, and that's relevant because every time anything on the screen moves, the entire screen actually has to be redrawn, right? So this is a limitation or just the way monitors and graphics worked at this time in history and for a lot of history. So if you have a huge amount of information on the screen, even if it's not moving, to then make a small change to the screen, and you can see this because the graphics do freak out sometimes, is like, it's still very processor intensive. So while they are not stunningly detailed and staggeringly beautiful, it's like I kind of get it. Like, they had to cram a ton of information into what probably at the time amounted to a 12-inch television.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I would say that the graphics, you know, they were way more stunning in my mind, you know, through my nostalgia goggles. But that being said, I don't think that I was super far off, you know, where I was remembering, you know, this, you know, 2017 like Transformers Revenge of the Fallen, you know, level of, and I was like, oh no, it's this. The main thing that I kind of got out of it was, you know, that basically they took a game, chess, which, you know, is very, very well known, right? But they added this layer of visuals that made it appealing as a game to younger children, you know, like, in my opinion, you know, because if there is only one thing that can be more boring than not knowing how to chess and trying to play chess is watching somebody does not know how to play chess trying to play chess, right? So this actually took that away, though, right? Because now, like, I remember, and even now, like, being enjoying watching somebody else play, because, you know, you could still get like a fun little animation when, you know, two pieces clashed, and it also made it feel like more like a actual like battlefield struggle as opposed to like a distillation of that, you know?
Right. Which, I mean, chess is several iterations removed from the original like war campaign games. Like, I can't remember what you call that style of game, but like, it was literally like generals with real, you know, little figurines that represented real soldiers, and they were trying to figure out how to win a real war, right? And then right. over the ages, that eventually morphed into chess. So saying, oh, we're going to make it, you know, about combat, and the pawns literally kill each other, and, you know, the bishop literally stabs a guy with his staff, which is surprisingly sacrilegious. that's really not that big of a leap to say, like, oh, there's combat going on, because, like, yeah, like, that's exactly what it's supposed to be.
Oh, absolutely. And actually, the bulk of my notes in visuals are just some of the truly like wacky stuff, because I feel like a lot of them, they did a good job scaling it, like making it make sense. You know, like when a pawn defeats a pawn, that's fine. And when for instance, when a knight takes a pawn, the knight just seems bored, you know, yes. like he's just kind of like bink, like, dude, this is not worth my time. And generally, if a much more powerful piece takes a weaker piece, like the animation is really, you know, intense with like how much more powerful that person is, you know, whereas, you know, when the pawn takes anything, like you just really feel like he is just, I don't know how this is happening, you know, like, how am I accomplishing this? With the one exception, though, to that being when a pawn takes a bishop. So did you see all of the different animations?
So we will talk later about me and my chess ability, but I actually, so that I could be positive, I saw every single animation. I actually made a point to look up a video on YouTube of every single, like, this piece takes that piece, right? Every single one, because they're actually all unique, which is freaking awesome.
Yes. Yeah. And I did the same thing, because the couple of times I played it, I remember when I would play it back in the day, just it being like an animation, like a story. It was just awesome. You know, like all these different facials, and it was great. And now that I'm a little bit better at chess, I'm like, and these animations are pretty few and far between. Oh, right. Because if you're good at playing chess for the first like 10 minutes, you're not hemorrhaging pieces. You're jockeying for position. Right. So like I played for like 10, 15 minutes. I'm just kind of like, man, this is not very animation heavy. Oh, right. Because we're playing well, you know? So I did the same thing where I just kind of like watched all of the different, you know, pieces to make sure, especially because that way I knew that I had seen all of them, you know,
instead of trying to check off your own list.
Exactly. But do you remember the animation for the pawn destroying the bishop?
I don't. I took notes on some specific ones that made me like really cock an eyebrow. One of them actually made me exclaim out loud, but I don't. I know. the only one I have for the pawn is that when a pawn defeats a queen, he stabs her in the back.
Yes, he stabs her in the back, and then she falls in a very ungraceful position.
Yes.
Which I was just kind of like, I wasn't, yes,
yeah,
whatever. I was like, that didn't need to happen. But no, when a, so the pawn, I mean, they're pawns, right? They are like low-level foot soldiers. So most of their kills feel that way, you know? With the exception of the pawn killing the bishop, where he opens the earth and the bishop just falls into a hole. And I was like, you could do that the whole time? You know?
Why are you just now bringing this up? We would have had an entirely different battle strategy.
Yeah, and so the only two things I can think of is, one, I wasn't super, you know, like, A Clockwork Orange, like eyes peeled watching this, so I'm not confident that I may have missed something. So it may have been that the bishop tried to magic the pawn and then the pawn like reflected it, or what I much more so believe is that in this particular narrative is that the bishop was corrupt and thus the pawn was able to evoke the bishop's god against him.
Yeah, no, all right. I like that, because there is a strong element of magical realism happening here, where like the bishop does some magical things. The queen weirdly also has like a bunch of magic, which I guess makes sense because she's supposed to be a very powerful piece.
Yes.
And she doesn't obviously have a weapon like a sword or something the way a knight does. But I think you're D&Ding that up quite a bit. but I'm okay with it. I'm going to allow it.
Yeah, I mean, for those of you that are going to go out and play the game, don't get your hopes up too high about, you know, this the narrative structure of this, you know.
So let's we could trade off if you want, or if you have like a short list, but there's a few of those animations that, like, this is really the meat of the visuals for Battle Chess, right? Because
yeah, let's just fire them back and forth. Like, yeah. Let's just go through our list of crazies.
Yeah. So the two, my one and two crazies. So I'll give you this, my number two spot first is when the rook defeats most of the enemies it defeats, it like smashes them on the top of the head, which yeah. I thought was shockingly gruesome until I saw the way it defeats the queen.
Yep.
Which is that it eats her.
Oh yes. So, bones and all.
Yeah. So the rook, you know, for if you've never seen a chessboard, right? So the rook, also called a castle because it looks like a castle, right? Mm-hmm. Or like a tower on a castle. Because it needs to move and have like autonomy in the game, it transforms into like a little stone golem, right? Mm-hmm. And so when it moves on the board or when it is in combat, it is in like its stone golem form. And so it has like a face and hands, and it like grabs the queen as she tries to flee and lifts her up and drops it into this gaping otherworldly maw, and she's just gone.
Yes. Yeah, she is just defeated. And it, best guess, I would have to say, is that there may have been some like CEOs or higher ups saying, you're like, you can't have a stone golem beat the queen to death, you know, because that's like, you've seen that's common, you know, which yeah. is kind of like, well, it's okay for them to murder like these soldiers, but like if he did the same like downward thing, because, you know, there's the pawn, which is armored, the knight, which is armored, the bishop, it makes a sound like he's like his cap is armored, even though it's not, you know?
Yeah. It does the clangy noise, but yeah.
Yeah. But anyways, but yeah, I mean, like if he were to just do that to the queen, I think that would have probably raised some eyebrows, but yeah, no, I, that animation was actually the one that I remembered the most distinctly, you know, oh, like I remembered that one. I was like, yep, there it is.
I don't know why, but the ones that stood out in my mind were the queen offing people with her magic.
The queen offing people with her magic is cool. My number one, is the king
versus when the bishop?
Yes. Yeah, when he pulls out a gun and shoots him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. As the bishop attempts to flee again, like another like yeah. realizes he is out of his depth, even though he can do magic, and like
No, I mean, all of the kings are a little ridiculous, because I think it's just kind of like the king shouldn't be capturing pieces, you know, like if you've gotten yourself into the position where like the king, and I'm sure I'm going to get like, well, actually to death in the, you know, comments, because like this is definitely tangential. For many years, I struggled to find a good way to describe like my chess ability, because I would always say, like, to be like, how good are you at chess? And I'd be like, I'm a little bit like I'm, you know, a 4 or a 5. Right. But the problem with chess is that you have, you know, people who don't know how to play at all. Then like the scale of people who know how to play, and then the people who like live it, you know, who can, you know, fire back and forth. And so I always like comparing myself like to them who are an extreme outlier. Right. So, so then I was just kind of like, okay, well, I would say that I am better than 90% of the populace, you know? So like the remaining 10% are way better than me, you know? So, right. But yeah, people are going to be like, well, actually in, you know, the Kapersky opening, and I'm just, I don't know any of that.
Yeah. Just, nope. Yeah. And the
recreation.
Yeah. And this is, I got a whole thing for you all about this later, but I think I was wondering, one thing about the animation specifically that I was wondering about is like, as we, when we decided we were going to play this game, there was that little part of me that was like, I think it's still chess though. Like it's still chess, right? Like I can't like button mash during the combat scenes and like win when I'm not supposed to win, or it's not like random, right? Like it always goes to the person who should have won. And it in fact does, right? Like it's
yes.
Right.
So yeah, that, it is still chess.
Yeah. And that's part of why I think they made it a point to make the visuals for the time, as kind of spectacular as they are, because if you are playing a bad game of chess and your pieces are being like just absolutely destroyed, you still get to kind of like enjoy the little animations, right? And you get to like see the queen like magic all your people to death, or see the bishop like stab them with his what do you call it? I don't know, his Jesus staff. I don't know what you call it. It's got a big cross on top.
His Jesus staff.
Yeah, he's definitely some kind of Christian denomination.
I'd say he's probably a bishop.
Well, I mean, lots of things have bishops. I mean, chess even has a bishop. But he like, so he stabbed. I'm just gonna plow onward. So he, you know, the fact that
David,
he like,
there's your sex tape, by the way. I'm just gonna plow onward.
I can't see the thing that I was trying to say was he just stabs them to death, which now as a follow-on sentence to that sentence is not. We should probably just go on. So I do like that. Did you see the knight versus knight?
Yeah, I forget what it was. I didn't make my list.
So I.
It did. The knight versus knight is a Monty Python reference.
Yes, it's totally a Monty Python reference. Like, and it was one of those things where like, I saw it and I was like, wait a minute, this is suspiciously familiar. And then like when it, you know, the dawning realization, I was like, yes, well done. Good job, team. Everybody can go home early.
Round of golf clap, you know. Yeah. Absolutely. Cause I saw that and he was like, bam, he hit his one arm. I was like, huh, bam, his other arm. I'm like, do it, you know? And then like cut off his leg. I was like, yes, good. This is good. But that one definitely stood out to me. Let's see. So that was one thing. The castle, the rook animations are awesome. Like I really like, you know, because like you said, it's like beating him over the head, right? So I had a personal realization, which was that the rook animations being so awesome, and the rook itself being, you know, like this like hulking golem-esque creature that, you know, like moved around the board, actually set my chess game back, I think, by a few years, because I way overused the rook. Like in my early, like, you know, I was like 10, you know, ish, like, so I'd be like, oh, I gotta get my rook out first. And my parents were always like, that's not a great strategy. You know, like your rook can't do much at the beginning of the game. It's better at the end of the game. I'm like, no, I got to move the rook around though. Like, cause moving the rook is awesome.
Have you seen him? He's huge.
Yeah, just straight up offs people. So all of a sudden I was just kind of like, maybe this might've actually had a hand in that. So the one other one, this is, so I did like all the queens, you know, super powerful magic stuff. I thought that they did a good job making that feel unique. You know,
she is a powerful piece in the game, but you don't get the sense that she's indestructible because she's not beating people to death. She has magic, right? So it's like they kind of almost are communicating like, oh, you don't want to overuse her because if you lose her, you're going to be super sad, right? Whereas with the rook, they were kind of sending the opposite message like, oh, man, this dude's unstoppable.
But the one other animation that I saw that just I'm really interested if you could shed some light, if you could see, because I watched it a couple of times. I was like, I don't know. Is it when the king takes the queen? Did that ping on your radar? I don't know what's happening there.
I don't remember. I'm tempted to go look it up right now, though.
Do that and I will just describe it to you. Yeah. So
some theater in mind.
Yeah. So basically, from near as I could tell, is that the king and queen approach one another. I can't remember if the queen starts to run away or not, but he embraces her, and then she just dies.
That's upsetting in a lot of ways.
Right? I saw that, and I was like, wait, what? And I ran it back. And when she dies, she's, like, colorless. You know? It looks like he, like, vampired her.
Jesus.
Did you see it?
No, but like I'm you're whetting my appetite quite a bit.
So yeah, I don't know what, but that's the thing is I watched it a couple times. I'm like, I don't know what's happening here. Is he like, I wasn't sure if he, you know, poisons her, because it looks like she may have been poisoned, or if it's a situation where, like, you know, he, what was it, in the Gladiator, he, you know, Maximus'd her, you know, where, like, he, like, brings her in close and then, like, stabs her in the kidney, you know? Or what, but I was like, I don't care for this. Luckily, a king taking a queen, I imagine, is a very uncommon thing to see, so one would not see it regularly, but it's kind of weird.
Wait, hang on. Oh God.
Yeah.
And yeah, I'm not really not sure what they're trying to communicate there. Hang on, I'm gonna watch it one more time.
And this is definitely, you know, to a degree a failure of, I mean, not a failure, but a limitation of, you know, the NES, where, like, they can't get super intense with some of the motions just because of the lack of fidelity. But at the same point in time, I'm like, then don't do this. I mean, if you...
Okay, so here's my final verdict on this.
Okay.
Because he definitely puts his hands around her. One of them is up, like, near the nape of her neck, and the other one is, like, down around her waist, like they are embracing.
Yeah. And then she just dies.
I wonder if he snaps her neck.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, possibly.
Which is super brutal if that's what's happening.
It's like, yeah. But anyway, so that one definitely made my list of, like, I don't... Actually, my literal note was... I have no idea what the king is doing to the queen, and I don't want to know.
Yeah. No, I'm not, now that I've watched that several times on a loop, I'm not surprised I missed it the first time, because it's so nondescript, right?
Like, right.
If the graphics were a little better, or if they did what they could and there was, like, a little flash and it was like, oh, he, like, stabbed her in the back, right? Or something, but she falls to the ground and is, like, kind of half sitting up and then collapses. So
yeah.
I guess if he was snapping her neck, she would just crumple in a heap. So I'm thinking, like, kiss of death or stabbing her, like, in the kidney or something, because she definitely goes out in a painful way. That's not the sweet embrace of death that you get from a neck snap.
No. So yeah, that one Ooh. Definitely stood out for me. But aside from that, generally overall, I felt that the visuals were what you would expect, you know, especially because I know that they remade this game a couple of times. I don't know for what platforms. I just remember that there was, you know, there were actually, you know, higher resolution games and all that good stuff. But yeah, I mean, like, you know, if you have NES graphics in mind, then this is pretty much what you'd be expecting. If you were saying, like, oh, well, we get some cutscenes of, like, you know?
Yeah. And I mean, it all kind of shakes out in the end, but it's slow. Like, that's, and we'll talk about this a little bit more later, but, like, that's my one real problem with the visuals, is not the lower fidelity. It's they
how godforsaken slow everything moves.
Yeah. They plod, like, everything plods. Yeah. And, the last thing I'll say about the visuals is, and I know this is really nitpicky, but, like, once my brain saw it, I was like, oh, good. Now I'm never going to unsee this.
Like, improper kerning.
Yeah, exactly. So the pieces are all standing on the board,
mm-hmm.
and you can see their faces, but you're looking straight at the board as if you were, like, leaning over the table and looking straight down. Like, your eyes are parallel to the board and yet somehow not parallel to all the pieces. And once I noticed that, I was just like, okay, David, they couldn't, on this hardware, they did not have a good way to make the board look like it was laying at an angle. This is not that big of a deal. And it's not that big of a deal, but you can change the pieces to look like normal stereotypical chess pieces. I don't know why you would do that, but that is actually an option that the game affords you. And that bothered me so much less, because I was like, oh, now it's a representation of a chessboard. But when there's little people with little faces walking around, I was like, how are you doing that? How are you standing on there? What do you got? You got, like, magnet feet? What are you doing?
Yeah, and that's right. I think that's the only choice they could have made. But yeah, it's one of those things where it's like, you guys just leaning way far back, you know, like, are you guys laying down?
You just 32 Michael Jacksons all leaning over at like an impossible angle. Like, how you doing this?
But yeah, so if you don't have anything else for visuals, audio?
Well, I have in my notes here a delightful transition between these two topics, which is I showed pray tell me more. So I wanted Susan to sympathize with me for how terrible it is on the select screen when the cherub wings are flapping.
Mm.
So she. Yes, forever yeah. and ever and ever. So she was sitting next to me while I was playing and taking notes. So I intentionally went to the select screen and I was like, how awful is that sound? And then she looked and she was like, why are there angels? Why are there little old man angels at all? And I was just like, old man angels? And then I looked at their faces and I was like, ah, crap, they do look like little old men. Like, she was like, why aren't they dragons or like something more medieval? And I was like, well, they're cherubs. And she was like, but why are there cherubs?
Yeah, but why cherubs? Yeah, I don't, the whole select screen, both visuals and audio, like the fact that there was a select screen was 100% necessary. Like, that has to happen, right?
The fact that it was behind the select button and not the start button, but I digress.
Yeah, no, but that's the thing. I'm like, but that is where the good decisions in that arena ended. You know, like, every other decision that was made, from the visuals of the cherubs to the fact that it's very occluded to get to, because, yeah, I hit start and got nothing. And so I played for a little while before I was actually able to find the menu, you know, to the fact that it makes that godforsaken grating sound, to the way that it's top to bottom. I'm like, all of these. The fact that this exists is good, and then everything after that is just hot garbage. Honestly, overall, for the sound, so first of all, there's no music, right?
No, there's a little jingle on the title screen where it says Battle Chess, and it plays, and that song is actually like okay. There's like a little medieval, you know, war sounding kind of song, and then that's it for music.
That's it. So as far as sound effects go, I found all of the sound effects personally to be painfully grating.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Like they're, I mean, honestly, I listened to it at first. And then once I kind of had a couple of notes, I just turned the volume as low as I could, you know?
Yes.
And
you acted correctly.
Yeah. Because the, like the clanging of metal on metal is, and you know, you would have better notes on this, but it's just like, it's very high pitched, you know, and like twangy, you know. So it's like clang, and you're like, ugh, God, it hurts, you know. And I know the NES could make different, betterer sounds, you know.
Well, and you know what this game had, my favorite thing for games to have.
Oh, a walking noise.
Yes, but in their defense, and I am saying this seriously, different characters or different pieces, god damn it, I knew I was going to do this, like, it's, I want to use chess terminology, but it's really hard. different chess pieces, because they are clothed differently or armored differently, or are stone golems that have been enchanted by a rabbi, like they
stone columns differently.
Yes, they they all make I think there's like a half a dozen different walking noises. So there's still walking noises, which I still hate. And because the animations are so slow, the walking noises go on way longer than I would like. But at least you're not hearing the one and only walking noise nonstop the entire time you're playing the game. You hear the pawn walking noise and the knight walking noise and the bishop walking noise and the rook walking noise. So it's like, that actually helps quite a bit. So I would rather just not have a walking noise or have some like way less grating walking noise, but the fact that there are multiples is not a bad middle ground. It does actually take a lot of the teeth grinding out of it.
Yeah, it does. And I think that the idea is to make it a more immersive experience, because that's basically what they're trying to do, is trying to make chess like immersive, you know?
Yeah.
Yes, but what would we call it? Chess battle? No, that's no good. But yeah, I mean, like, so there's the clanging of them going back and forth, which, I mean, to me, again, you're playing this game mostly, again, for the immersive experience. And so the fact that they made all the sound effects, like, make you want to blow your brains out just really consistently took me out of it, you know, to the point where I was like, do I really want, I mean, like, to take this piece? I mean, it's the right move, but I'm going to have to hear, you know, the knight fight a knight, and as awesome as that is, and like how what a cool reference it is, it's gonna be loud, you know. And
it definitely, I mean, this era, like, they don't get a free pass, but they definitely didn't have it deeply ingrained in their psyches, like, oh, we want people to play our games for hours and hours on end, and what is that going to be like, right? Because they were so busy being like, oh my God, we can make these knights fight each other. And it's like chess, but with like knights fighting each other, right? Like, they just, I don't begrudge them being focused on these other things. I am glad that eventually, as a community, game designers realized that things like grating, repeating sound effects are not good.
Yes. And to me, the keystone of grating awful sound effects, the real piece that just brings it all together into a beautiful symphony of awful is the queen, man. The queen's eek is,
yeah,
it just, I hear that in my eyes, you know. it's just awful, dude. Like, it just it hits that resonant frequency where I'm just kind of like, oh God, you know. And the fact that it's every time she dies, it's like eek, and you're like, well, why?
And in some of the animations, she eeks more than once because, like, someone takes a swing at her and they miss, or she tries to flee, so she eeks when she starts running, and then when they make contact with their weapon, she eeks again. Like, so not only do you have to hear that noise, but it's one. There aren't, like, three or four different eeks. There's one eek, and you have to hear it repetitively. And, oh, God. At least I think when she takes pieces, she never makes that noise, which is, like, a tiny little silver lining.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, you never really, you know, it's not good if you're basing decisions, if your players are saying like, how can I minimize a part of the game experience, you know, like, this is so awful that I want to experience the minimum of it possible, you know, like, the only time, in my opinion, that you should be doing that is if you are trying to disincentivize that particular player activity. A beautiful example of that, I believe, is the death mechanic in The Last of Us, you know, where basically what they did was they made the visuals so viscerally terrible that you don't want to see that, you know?
Oh, you mean the little, like, 2-second cinematic of, like, your head being ripped in half by the bloaters? Because the bloaters literally rip your head in half at the jaw. They grab you like King Kong grabs a T-Rex and rips your head asunder, and it's horrible.
Oh yeah, no, because they cut it out right as your face begins to unnaturally stretch. You know, yeah, that. No, I saw that the first time. I was like, nope, never again. And of course, it happened a couple more times. So I went out of my way, and it added to that, like, sense of, like, foreboding and terror. And even though there was no mechanical, disincentivizing to die, you know, because it just puts you back, like, whatever, a minute at the most, you know, I was just kind of like, nope, it added to that terror. So that's a good reason to do that, you know, is if you were saying, like, we are creating a thing that is awful because we want you to not want to experience it, right? That's the only reason I can think of to do that. And this is not that. I mean, because, again, if it was saying like, oh, well, you don't want to hear the queen eek because, you know, that means that you lost your queen and that's bad, I get that, except for the fact that when you take a queen, you also would hear that eek, and that's a good thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, so there isn't that level of consistency. And
right.
I mean, again, not to just give them a pass on unfortunate design choices, but I suspect that sort of thing wasn't even really in the literature, right? Like, there literally was no the literature. So it wasn't until later that they were like, oh, wait, this is sending kind of mixed signals. And that's even assuming that they found this noise grating. They may have been like, right, oh my God, this square wave sounds like a woman yelling, and we have a woman and we need her to yell.
Yep. Boom. Done. Ship it. And I really do think that, you know, you kind of hit the nail on the head where they were just kind of like, what if chess came to life. And then somebody's like, we have the technology, we can do this. And then like they just threw themselves. And to be fair, I mean, that it's awesome. I mean, it's an awesome concept, you know, but then that was kind of where some of the deliberate choices started to end, you know, was again, you know, like that's where they kind of stopped being quite as careful, you know?
Yeah. And so let me, cause I think we're both champing at the bit to get to like the mechanics of how this all plays out.
Yes.
So the last thing I want to say about the audio is it really felt like, and I think this probably was an intentional choice, they did the minimum amount of audio necessary for this game to have audio, because it would be a lot less spectacular if the characters like swords clashing didn't make sword clashy noises. So I totally get why they would do that. And the magic has to have magic noises, and the footsteps apparently have to make footstep noises. Like, I get all that.
They do. No, they do. I'm telling you.
Moral imperative.
Don't roll your eyes. Don't sit there and roll your eyes. It has to happen.
Yeah, it's like manifest destiny, like more God given imperative. But
I mean, for me personally, when I go to bed, man, you know, I get a nice glass of water. I set it on my nightstand, you know, and I lay in the bed, and then I just put the Mario walking in Donkey Kong on a loop.
Yeah. It's like a white noise machine, except you kill yourself. So,
right. No, it's nice, because what I actually find soothing about it is not the noise itself, but the fact that it is just the biggest middle finger to you, you know, like, and then I just cuddle up warm and I'm like, go to hell, lions.
Yeah, I assume anyone who's ever met me, there's a whole cottage industry of like, I could sell them things that they know I don't like, just that they could take delight in. I really cut myself off at the knees there. But like, so the fact that there's no music, I think, is a deliberate choice, because if you had, if you just had music playing on a loop, it would probably get really, really grating.
Oh yeah, you'd hang yourself for sure.
Right. And if you, I think in a modern chess game, what would actually be kind of cool, now that we have like more games, design literacy, and more powerful equipment, is it would be cool to write music that got like more tense as you played worse, or got like more triumphant as you played better. Like,
oh, I'd be feeling that. Yeah.
Right. Like, that would be a really cool atmospheric thing to do, that not only do I suspect they did not necessarily consider at this time in history, but definitely would not have had the ability to execute on. So even if you had some brilliant designer who pulled this out of whole cloth, right, this idea that he had no prior reason to suspect might ever be a thing that would happen, he would then still have looked at the Nintendo's processing power and been like, not today. Right. So So I feel like they did the minimum amount of audio necessary, but I don't think that that was a strict limitation. I think they explicitly said, let's not do music.
Yeah. And I agree. And now that you've said it, I really want that, because one of the things I found out recently when playing Darkest Dungeon, that I didn't even notice, like, and you know, after playing it for about like 10 hours, was the fact that it does that with your light level. Right. The music, the encounter music, gets way more and more intense the darker it is when you're in a battle. And I'm just like picturing that now, where at first it's just kind of like, you know, kind of like normal music. And they'd have to make it so it's long enough so that way you could listen to it for 20 minutes straight and it wouldn't become grating or repetitive. You know, you could even probably break it up with like battle music, you know, but then, and that'd be actually a good way to like shift the score. Right. Is that like every time you know, lose a piece of like a certain point value, right? Like that's when it'd go into, you know, battle music, right? And then when it comes back out, the tone has shifted a little bit, you know, like in the overarching score. Yeah, I that would be awesome. But also, there's no way they were going to be able to do that. I agree completely. And so then, yes, then no music, because if there was like music to it, I can guarantee you that it would not just processing power alone, like there's no way they could have made it long enough to not get super repetitive, which means that you just mute it.
Yeah.
You know,
it would be a jingle that played on a loop, just like a lot of people mute or they either turned off the music in or turned off the sound on their television when they played Tetris or Dr. Mario. It's like, because you're here for the mechanics of the game. You're not here for the music, right? And I totally get that, right? So that's it'd be neat if someone executes on my atmospheric battle chess music idea. That's free, internet. You can have that. Just somebody make it happen. And then when you're done, go out in front of your house. But now we can talk about the mechanics.
So I I'm assuming that we're going to be hitting the mechanics from, you know, the game, not the mechanics of chess itself, which I don't think either of us have really the skill to pick apart in a very erudite fashion.
I don't think either of us have the ability to pick apart the mechanics of chess. And if we did, someone would go out in front of their house and scream like, "You assholes!" Like, yeah. there's no way either of us are equipped to pick apart chess. But I do want to specifically address something because you know this and I know this, but I need to make sure our listeners know this because it's really relevant to a lot of the things I'm about to say. I know how to play chess, as in I know the rules, I know how the pieces move. I am no good at chess. I'm not good at all, like not even a little. And when I sat down to start playing this, picking it apart in a way I never would have as a kid or even just a few years ago, I realized that there are a lot of opportunities in modern chess games, which surely most modern chess games probably do this, but this game does not, which is this is literally just a board game made digital. And the biggest difference between a board game and a video game is a video game can teach you how to play it. And this game doesn't do that. So if you sit down to play this, you are as good at chess when you play battle chess as you are when you play tabletop chess. There is zero difference between them. And for someone who is trying to get better at chess or who is already good at chess and just enjoys playing chess and needs like a computer opponent, that's fine. But for me, if I said, I want to learn how to get better at chess, I can't really do that with battle chess because it has some mild teaching functionality, but it's not really trying to teach you how to be a better chess player. It assumes you know how to play chess and that you are here to play chess.
Yes. No, it definitely, it's not an instructional tool. I don't think that they set out to make it one. They do have a...
suggest, you know, they move. Have a couple.
Yeah, yeah, the success move or whatever.
Is it not suggest?
It might be. I don't know. like to be fair, I saw it just a couple of times, and I was reading it. I thought it said success move, but anyways, whatever. It's probably suggest move. So it does have that, you know, which I think is nice, you know. And you could leverage that if you're like, okay, what should I do next? What should I do next? To kind of like at least get an idea for like general progression, but. Honestly, thinking about it, like I don't know how well, like I think that if they tried to make it into like a chess tutorial, that would have probably been well beyond the scope or capability of the game, just because of the depth of chess, you know, that they were like, no, we're just trying to make battle chess, man. We're not trying to teach you to play chess. That's all we're trying to do.
Yeah, and I'm not, to be clear, I'm not chiding them. I don't think they were trying to make a chess tutor and they did a piss poor job of it. I think they were not trying to make a chess tutor at all. And then because they have to build in AI for the computer to play chess against you, they were like, well, we'll just give you a button that says suggest move, and we will tell you what we would do if we were controlling your side of the board, which you can actually do. You can make the computer control both sides of the board. So the fact that it's doing all that math all the time is what it has to do to be able to play chess. So it's like they're not trying to make a chess tutor, and they just kind of tossed in those two functions because they're neat. But like as someone who... Because I feel like a lot of games are not like this, right? Like, if you know the rules of the game, you usually have enough information to become better. Chess is not like that. Chess is so... The rules are very narrow, but the strategy is exceptionally deep. And because of that, knowing the rules is nowhere near enough information to become better at the game. I mean, I've known the rules of chess since I was a small, small lad. Like, I don't even remember learning chess is how long I've known how to play. And I suck at chess.
Well, I mean, I do remember, though, having fond memories in college where, you know, when we would sit down and be like, it's time to get crunk. You know what we should do? Play drinking chess. And
yeah.
And play
Get Lion Strong.
Yep, that was the game, because what I love the most about drinking chess is, so like obviously, you know, you drink the point value of the piece as it's taken. The strategy changes because the goal, because when you get mated, you finish your drink, right? Mm-hmm. So the goal became bleed lions out until he's finished his drink and has made a new one, then mate him, you know? So that adds another layer of difficulty, you know?
Yeah. Well, I have two chess stories that I think of when I think of you in particular. One is that, right? Because like a handful of times, you know, a party was getting started at our apartment and like you went for a chessboard and I was like, no, it's fine. Right. Because some people are just like, what is that guy doing? But also, I think literally the first time we played chess together, you were like, oh, do you know how to play chess? And I was like, I know the rules of chess. And then we sat down and, you know, the Ronsky feint or whatever, like one of the ways you can beat someone in like five moves. Mm-hmm. Like we started playing and after your third move, you just went, do you know what I'm doing? And I went, playing chess. And you were just like, let's reset the board.
Like, no. Okay. So you're about to lose. So, okay. Let's do this again. But yeah, and so I definitely don't think, like I said, like I don't think this game is trying to be a chess tutor. Here's my big kind of gripe with that is that, so I sat down to play, and again, I am no Kasparov or Deep Blue, right? By no means, you know.
So modest.
yes. I mean, no, not even close. I would never pretend to be, right? But I'm not bad at this, right? So I sat down to play, and I was just kind of like, all righty, and I was just kind of really half-heartedly paying attention, you know, and I started getting like wrecked, you know, and this was, and we can touch on that, was the fact that the select screen is kind of obscured, you know, so like hitting start doesn't bring up options, right? And you're not immediately dumped into options before the game starts.
No, in fact, so the second you press any button on the title screen, it just starts a game of chess. It doesn't ask you what difficulty you want. It doesn't communicate to you that that's a thing you can change.
Which was a problem because literally I didn't remember that there was a select screen, right? So I just was like, oh, okay. So I started playing and I started getting wrecked and I was like, how could you ever make any kind of chess game and not with an AI and not be able to select the strength of the AI? I was like, that's like 100% imperative. You know, if you were going to make a game that it has any audience whatsoever, aside from the five people that slot in at that exact skill level to where that's challenging, but not crushing. Right. So I was just blown away. So then, you know, like I started to lose and I was like, okay, so I reset it and like started to pay attention. I was like, this person's, you know, it's pretty decent. And then I found out that there was a select screen. So I was like, ah, there we go. So I'm just going to dumb down the difficulties. That way I can like take some better notes. And it was on the lowest possible difficulty. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wait, that's fine. And I don't want to sit here like break my arm, pat myself on the back. But at the same point in time, I'm like, I'm not bad at this. And if this is the lowest difficulty and I'm finding it challenging, one, I don't even want to know what difficulty five is. And two, who's your intended audience that you think is playing battle chess, right? Do you think it's like 30-year-old chess masters or do you think it's probably a whole bunch of 10-year-olds? Why did you make the lowest difficulty this difficult? You know, there's no way. Now I'm thinking about it, I'm like, there's just no way I ever beat this game as a kid, you know?
I mean, I certainly didn't. So you know, I know that's not a good calibration, but
I mean, no, but I think that it is, though, because, you know, that's the thing, is it's like there should be a difficulty to where it's like, do you just know the rules and have no idea on strategy whatsoever? Then you should have you are playing a lobotomized opponent level, right?
Yeah, there should be a difficulty that's like chance, right? Like if you know the rules of chess, which technically the game won't allow you to make an illegal move, so if you just keep pressing buttons, eventually you would play a game of chess. Like there should be a mode that is like essentially 50-50. Like if you just move pieces virtually at random, as an unskilled player is essentially doing, then you have a chance of winning because the other person is playing also virtually at random.
Right. Yeah. I mean, like, and, you know, just doing like some very basic base level strategy, like, again, knowing how the game is played. But yeah, that should be like novice should be novice, you know, not. And again, like I said, to me, I was just kind of like, oh, OK, so apparently I am playing on the easiest possible difficulty. And there's 6 total difficulty levels. So I was just kind of like, again, I didn't even bother setting it to level 5, you know, because, you know, it's just kind of like walking in and being like, oh man, you know, this is 10 times Earth's gravity. And you're like, if it was 400, maybe you'd have an advantage, but 10, I don't even feel it, you know, like that. So I didn't even bother with level 5, but at the same point in time, again, I was just kind of like, I know, or I'm confident that they were, as with all games of this era, were targeting young children. Right. You know, like children between.
And the Nintendo in particular was marketed. I mean, in you know what it was called in Japan, right? The Famicom, short for family computer.
No, there you go.
Right. So it's like this was not marketed at like adults who were MIT graduates and hardcore tech enthusiasts. This was marketed, as Nintendo has essentially always been, two families. Like, this is something mom, dad, you know, Jimmy and little Susie will all love playing together. And you know, white picket fence and a dog with a black spot around one of its eyes. Like, it very... Yeah. Nintendo has been nothing if not consistent. So it is really odd that they would be like, oh, a chess game. But maybe this one's not for the kids. Maybe they figured the violence made it skew like teenage to adult, so maybe slightly more sophisticated chess players, but it really seems
slightly odd. More sophisticated type chess players, though. I mean, like, that's the thing, is that, you know, like, if you compare, you know, a 10-year-old to a 15-year-old, yeah, there's a big difference there. But again, the thing is what I find odd is it super narrows the audience, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, if you're saying that, you know, novice is we expect you to have at least 5 years of playing chess under your belt to be able to compete, then it's like, well, why though? Because you can, and maybe I'm don't understand what goes into building chess AI, but it feels like if you can build good chess AI, that building bad chess AI, you know, like, is easier, you know? I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but
my understanding of chess AI is that there are a small enough number of possibilities for a computer, right? There are a small enough number of possibilities that it can compute enough of them that it is confident in the choice it makes. And so don't have it make that choice. Have it make one of the other choices it computed, or literally random noise. Like, every third move is the most logical move for the current state of the board, but the other two are just random, right? And like that would essentially dumb it down because it's not playing with its full faculties. So I mean, chess is not a solved game. It's not a solved game, but it is like, it is a computationally addressed game, even at this time in history. Like, this if they made a friggin' chess game for the Nintendo Entertainment System, they understood the math.
Right. And so, yeah, so that choice in and of itself just kind of completely threw me. Other mechanical things that I thought were interesting was, I mean, again, once I found that, so we kind of touched on the fact that the select screen is obscured was a just terrible choice. You know, I mean, again, because you have no reason to think that exists, you know,
the only thing I could think of that led to that decision is, it couldn't be A or B because it has A or B or select and cancel. So it couldn't be one of those. It can't be one of the directional buttons because you need the D-pad for movement. And they chose not to make it start, I would guess, because this game has no pause function. Because you don't pause a game of chess. When it's your turn, you just do
stop
nothing.
Chessing.
Yeah, the way you stop chessing is to not chess anymore. So
and then chess stops.
Right? So instead of overloading the start button and saying, oh, we'll put all of these options inside the pause menu, but there is no pause menu, they chose to say, like, well, we're not using select for anything, so we'll put all of the options one might select behind the select button, which, I mean, again, at the time was probably a completely rational form of reasoning that no one in the room would have cocked an eyebrow at. But now looking back, it's like, who uses select for anything?
Well, and not only that, but like, to me, again, the fact that there's nothing that tells you that there is something to select, you know?
And there is like dead space around the outside of the board where they absolutely could have put a little like press select for options.
Yeah. Or, I mean, as opposed to when you hit A or whatever, it immediately dumping you into the chessboard saying like, you know, like press start to begin game, press select for options. Or even if you wanted to poke-yoke the situation even better, right? Just have it dump you into that screen, like have it do like battle chess and then just be like, and here are your options. Because realistically, as far as like games go, like this is one where you absolutely want them to be aware of and possibly choose these options on the onset. You know, like you don't want to get halfway through a game and then be like, oh God, I was playing this level 5 difficulty. I'm going to be playing it on novice. Or the opposite problem where you're like, man, this chess game's dumb. Oh, right. Because the AI was set terribly, you know? So, I mean, again, you know, there's a million different ways it could have solved it. But like I said, like I played for a solid 30 minutes without knowing that this crucial item existed, you know? And so that to me is just, it's there. Like you said, like, you know, easily could have been a button along the side, easily could have been part of the, there's a million solutions to this problem that are so cripplingly low impact that the fact that they didn't do that is just, to me, near inexcusable. So
yeah, it really smacks of, well, did you push all the buttons on the controller? And it's like, don't ever make that a thing your player has to do. Don't ever make discovering a function, I just mashed the buttons. And the reason I think I find that to be like such an affront is the only way, because like, you know, you picture a Nintendo controller, right? Adorable little rectangle. Mm-hmm. We all know what they look like. But like, I'm holding my controller and it's like, well, I'm pretty positive there's like a difficulty select or some sort of option screen. Because I'm pretty damn games literate, I know it's not the D-pad, and because I have observed what A and B do, I know it's not A or B. The odds that it's A and B simultaneously are not zero, but they're close to zero. And start isn't doing anything, so I guess I'll try select. Oh, okay, select does it. And what I hate about that is it reminds me that I'm playing a video game. And
right.
I know that that's not really the end of the world for a game like chess, which is not, I mean, chess is a game, right? Like it is a game. Right. It's not
The whole point of battle chess is it's supposed to be immersive.
Right.
You know?
Right. That's what like, it shouldn't be a big deal when you're playing chess, but because you're playing this like, oh, watch the characters move around and brutally stab each other to death with their Bishop Jesus sticks. Like I need to suspend disbelief a little bit and like kind of get sucked into this world. And the controls are simple enough that unless I'm brand new to games, I'm probably not having to look down at my thumbs very often. But because I was like, I don't know how to get to this menu, it forced me to look at the controller and be like, well, there's only 4 buttons if you don't count the D-pad. And I know exactly what 3 of them do. So I guess it's this 4th one. I personally do not like having that feeling. I don't like thinking like, oh, I totally triangled this guy before I R1 and then up arrowed him. Like that's you shouldn't feel that way when you're playing like Street Fighter, right? Like you should feel like you Hadoukened them before you dragon punched them and then you tornado kicked them to death and then they slow motion fell off to the side of the screen. Like that's how you should feel when you play video games, as far as I'm concerned. If I'm ever thinking about the buttons, I'm not happy.
Well, and that's actually, I agree completely, because the idea, and this is something that, you know, the industry has learned, is that the controller is supposed to be an extension of the player. You know, it's like, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, well, you just, you know, pretend like the sword is an extension of your own arm. I think I got the basics. That's the final stage of mastery. it's that. And I think that, you know, you can see, well, you see tons of bad exemplars of it. But again, because apparently I'm just going to keep doing this, a good example of it is The Last of Us, is that there's a couple of times where they need to disorient the player, right? And they do that by either making your control sluggish because you're sluggish, or like at one point you are upside down. The way you interact with the world has not changed at all. You know, like they don't invert the controls on you, which creates a disconnect between the player and the game extension themselves. They make you, the player, have to deal with this new situation.
Right.
Right. You know, and so, and you see it in lots of other games where, like, they're like, oh, we'll just randomly invert the controllers. That'll throw them for a loop. And it's like, yes, and makes me intensely aware of the fact that I am playing a game. So, like, especially for battle chess, where it's supposed to be like you are the general and your pieces are an extension of your will, thus the controller is an extension of you, like, making you kind of, like, fumble with it to that degree is, again, you know, just, in my opinion, unacceptable.
Yeah, it is, at least in a game where it's reasonable to assume that everyone knows they're playing a game, and this was marketed as a game, right? At this time in history, they didn't really market games as, like, deeply immersive experiences. I mean, they kind of did, but not the way they talk about them now and have been for a few years. But, like, if you're going to take chess and dress it up, like, let me live in the fantasy a little bit. Like, let me not think about the fact that I have this little plastic rectangle in my hand just while the, you know, king snaps the neck of this woman, you know, whatever.
Yeah. Well, and so also, as something that it was kind of certainly immersion shattering, was, and we've kind of touched on it briefly, is like how holy crap slow everything is.
Oh, dude. I couldn't decide where to put that in my notes because I was like, I'm mad at this always. I could find a way to, I could complain about this in any section of my notes.
It's just kind of ubiquitous. Yeah, no, it's mind-blowingly slow. And the fact that, you know, it's like each person, like, takes, like, step, 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 and you're like, oh, God. Oh, God, it's still happening. And so, again, like, there were some times where I was like, do I really need to move my bishop all the way across the board? You know, like, I don't know. And then, so that's super obnoxious. The place where it came to full unacceptable to me is it's uninterruptible, right?
Yeah, you can't skip it.
Yeah, well, you can't, not only can you not skip it, but, like, for example, at one point I moved a piece, and then the opponent's queen immediately started to move, and I saw what they were going, like, immediately it clicked what they were going to do. I was like, shoot, no, I didn't see that. And I was like, and again, if you're using it as, like, a learning tool, you know, I'm like, okay, undo. Like, I missed that. I've learned. Let's try something else. Nope. You can't select. You can't do anything. You have to sit there and watch the entire thing play out, and then you can hit select and say, okay, now undo that. And so it's just kind of like the fact that it's like, it takes, you know, the idea is like, oh, well, it's like battle chess. Like, there is now immense battles, and you're gonna watch them. You know, like, now all of a sudden it's not like a fun, it's not a treat, it's an obligation, right? You know, it's like I was excited about this until I didn't, like, you know, like it's like, oh man, I get to watch Moana, you know, like, in the theaters, that's great. I'm just going out and grab some popcorn, and, like, the door clicks and you're like, I can't leave here whenever I want to. This isn't fun at all anymore.
Yeah, no, it definitely smacks the entire game. The NES battle chess specifically smacks of, we just recently learned what video games are, and
yeah,
that is relevant to the larger discussion, because, you know, what we have to ultimately get to. And I'm not trying to goad you into asking the final question, even though that was an amazing transition I should have saved. But, like, it there's just so many little design decisions that I was constantly having to do the thing that I don't like to have to do when I play a game, which is remind myself, they didn't know any better. They didn't know any better. They didn't know any better. It's fine. They didn't know any better. Right. Like, it's like you're, these people are all exceptionally talented programmers and developers and artists, and they did amazing things upon which all modern games and all future games will be built upon that foundation. But some of those experiences, you marvel at their foresight, and then some of them you're like, wait, the options are behind a menu, behind a button I never touch, and I have to know that it exists because I just fall right into the game? Like, none of those design decisions would be even passable today. Like, that game wouldn't ship. It wouldn't make it through QA.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, that's one of the things I really enjoy about this podcast is, like, it does remind you that we do stand upon the shoulders of giants, right? You know, it was so many, like, it's like, oh, I forget what but it's a certain, anyways, like a certain type of like building noise, right? Where it's like the trend is upwards, but there are always games like scatter plotted about the trend line, right? And, you know, like you said, like when you isolate some of these choices, you're just kind of like, and again, if you're constantly reminding yourself like they didn't know any better, it's like, yeah, that's the things they didn't. And honestly, I really do think that the idea was just, it's like, well, we are adding a layer onto a already hundreds year old game. Like we're just, all we're doing is adding visuals. That's all we got to do. That's it. You know, like that's all we're trying to do. And that's all we got to do. You know, add some awesome animations
and
ship it.
And the task that was, it's not like, yeah, oh, we're just doing this and we're doing the least possible. It's like, we're doing something that's going to be like super hard. Like we have to hand draw all of these animations. We have to program them in. We have to make the game successfully play chess, right? Like they probably couldn't just buy a chess engine. They probably had to write one for this game.
Yeah, no, there's actually an extra credits example that they give about like when you play your own game for long enough that some rules become intuitive to you. But apparently on one project, the tester sat down and said like, okay, like he was like working. He's like, how do I open the menu? And the answer was triple click the player.
Oh God.
And it was like, you know, that's not intuitive, right? But like for everybody on the team, they were just like, well, yeah, you know. And so I'm sure that as they worked with it, it was just like, it was just intuitive to them. But again, you know, I think that, and I'm certainly not making light of like, you know, at all points, I'm just kind of like, these people are working hard. It's just like, to them though, when they were setting out their goals, they were like, we are going to add a layer onto this additional game. And then that's the project, that's the goal. And they did that, you know, but then they didn't think like little minutiae of like, okay, well, the fact that, you know, like we added sound to a soundless game. It's like, yeah, but if the sound makes you want to hang yourself, it's not good. It's like, oh, we added all of these like walking animations. So it's like, yeah, but if it takes forever for anything to move, it becomes grating, especially when each piece has to politely get out of the way for a piece to move past it, right? So, I mean, God forbid you need to move your knight around a lot, because there's going to be a lot of people just being like, excuse me, sir. Oh, no, sorry. Oh, it's, you're fine, good bean. You know, like, and just, you know, like, very politely. I don't know. But like, none of that was...
Make way for Sir Jeffries. Oh, excuse me, Sir Jeffries. Oh, after you, Sir Jeffries. Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, no, so yeah, so the fact that, like, I just don't think that any of that... that there was, again, in this period in history, there was no need... There was no inherent need to be like these types of decisions. Like whenever you add a new piece, like these are some of the things that you need to double check and look for. Like it just wasn't done at the time, you know, but unless you have something more, I think that we do have a good transition to, did it hold up?
I do have a random thing I wanted to include just cause I think it's cute. And I want to give a little nod to Nintendo. So when you play a video game, regardless of the platform that you are playing that video game on, and you can change whether or not the video game is acting, right? So think like in Super Smash Brothers. When you are playing against Super Smash Brothers, can you think of what it says? Like, so for you, it would say George or like your initials or something. What does it say for those players?
CPU, typically?
CPU or often COM, right, for computer.
Right.
So this was originally a PC game, and when they ported it to the Nintendo, someone took the time to list the computer player as Nintendo. So, like, so when you go to the select screen and you are choosing difficulty, you can also choose which color you are. It's like, they call it blue, but it's kind of a purple. But it's like, you know, red and blue. So you can choose which one you want to be, and you can choose which one the Nintendo is, or you can make both of them human controlled if you actually want to pass the controller back and forth, or you can make both of them Nintendo controlled and make the AI fight itself to the death. But I just, honestly, I found it really charming that someone was like, well, it's not a computer controlled opponent. It's a Nintendo controlled opponent. And that just feels so Nintendo. Like that just feels like a thing that they weren't trying to be cutesy. They weren't trying to be, they're not egotistical. They're just like, but it's not being controlled by a computer. It's being controlled by the Nintendo. Like it's a Nintendo controlled opponent. Like, and you're, yeah. And you as the audience are like, Yeah, but come on, like, you're just trying to be funny. Like, instead of, you know, computer controlled opponent, it's Nintendo controlled opponent, and like, but it is a Nintendo controlled opponent, right?
Yes, Nintendo controls us.
Yeah, it just, yeah, no, the second I opened that screen, I saw that, I was just like, good on you, Nintendo. That is on brand, both literally and figuratively.
But yeah, so with all of that being said, did it hold up?
No, not for me. And not because the concept of Battle Chess doesn't hold up. This execution of Battle Chess does not hold up, which is an interesting thing that I don't know. This may be a first time thing we've dealt with on the show, but I would totally encourage someone who likes chess to play Battle Chess, just not this Battle Chess.
Right.
I would say play the original PC game, play one of the later remakes. Just don't play the Nintendo cartridge unless you somehow have fond memories of the Nintendo cartridge and only the Nintendo cartridge.
Yeah, no, you absolutely have to be wearing your nostalgia goggles to play this game. Yeah, I mean, and there were even like later iterations of it, you know, like where they were able to resolve a lot of these issues. This was a very, very good concept. And I think that the idea of like saying like, well, what if we took this kind of banal visual thing and, you know, supercharged it, right? Like, I think that that's a really good idea. I think that this is when we stand upon the shoulders of giants, this is a giant, you know. And I think that there's a lot more that they could do, like a lot more to you know, like build on from here. But ultimately, in the end, you know, like they were just like by the time I was done playing this game, I felt like an Australian at the end of a meal.
The curtain falls. The music plays, the credits roll, then it all fades to black, and you're left by yourself. The fanfare is gone, there's no player two there by your side to share victories won. But as you slowly progress down the hall to your bed, a few great events leak back into your head from the time that you spent traversing the land, battling evil, fighting the darkness, just sword in hand. Your memories creeping with the edge of a smile, you realize again what you've lost for a while. Gonna take back much less.